Hi, I'm going to tell a story about my dad, Jim Greenwood. He lives in Montana, and he was born in Opheim, which is northeast. It's basically by the Canadian border. And his siblings, he's got lots of them, they were basically raised for farm help. They had extra kids because they needed help on the farm, and they had wheat farms, and it was not an easy life. They went to school and they came home and they helped till dinner time when the sun was going down. And so my dad was the rebel of the bunch. And at 16, he got a motorcycle and he ran away from home and he drove to Billings, Montana, the big city. And so from there, later on, he met my mom. And I always called them the opposite, polar opposite. My mom was the soch and my dad was the greaser. So like the outsiders, the soch and the greaser came together, had me, and then needless to say, they're so different. They did get divorced, but now he's with my stepmom, Lila, and I have a big extended family. There's five of us kids, and they have raised me as though I'm part of the family. I have a half brother and step and sister and brothers. And every summer I would live with them for 3 months. My mom would fly me to Montana and I'd live with them and we would go camping. And that's where I learned to hike and to fish and to shoot guns, BB guns, rifles. And my dad was always very much of a outdoorsy man. So he would do things that were mountain man-like, sometimes embarrassed me. So my favorite memories, though, of him were from camping. And at 12 years old, he taught me how to drive on his lap, of course. So to this day, my song that reminds me of him is Alan Jackson's And Daddy Let Me Drive. So that song reminds me of him every time I hear it. And everything that reminds me of him is just camping and shooting guns. And so as redneck as my dad is, this morning, Christmas morning, 2012, he calls me, we're talking, and he sees a coyote outside circling the cattle that he has on his land. And says, Merry Christmas, darling, I love you. I gotta go shoot a coyote. And that's what he did. He shot a coyote this morning on Christmas Day, 2012. So that's my father, Jim Greenwood.
All right, the story that I know about John Pilato. When the name John Pilato comes up, it's kind of synonymous with my friends as well as myself, is proclaiming to run a 4440. For those that don't know what a 4440 is, he claims he ran the 40-yard dash in 4.4 seconds. He claims it's still up in the halls of San Ignatius High School, I believe, that I've never seen, or I don't think anyone's ever seen. So we've always used to razz him about it as we got older. We said, you know, you gotta run. And my mom and wife said, you can't, John, you can't run. You know, you're gonna have a heart attack. So we kept egging him on. And finally, I think in around junior high, maybe early high school, he's like, F it, I'm doing it. And he raced, I think, it might have been my friend Dave Gowing. So they were racing on the street, and we're like, he's just gonna get blown away. And he started racing, he got off to a little slow start, but then when he started accelerating, he just took off. And the whole time my mom was just yelling, John, you're gonna have a heart attack! John, you're gonna have a heart attack! He ended up winning the race. Fast forward a couple years later, he ended up having a little bit of heart problems, which coincidentally were not related to his running, but when he was in the car. So we're just happy to have him around this time now, around the winter time, which is right around the same time as when he had his heart issue. So I'm very thankful around this time that he's still alive as my dad, as well as supposedly running a 4440, which we never officially clocked, but he claims he did. But that's the story I always remember for sure.
Hi, I'm Susie Flip, and I'm here to talk about Mr. Flip. So many things in a lifetime that your father does. Funny things, sad things, supportive things. And what comes to mind most, I guess, was Dad always supported us for things happened when we couldn't finish school, if you got laid off at work. And Dad would come back and say, okay, Mom, I'll loan you the money, finish college, you can pay me back. So we did that. And I think I probably gave him whiplash when he was teaching me how to drive. because we must have traveled every side street in Chicago, parallel parking, until we were like, we had it down to a science. So for that, I'm grateful to my father for his patience and his love. That's all I have.
My dad's name is Bob Fortunato, and one of my childhood stories is one day we were going to the park one summer, and we were working on my grounders for baseball, and he was throwing me the grounder after grounder, and one of them popped up, and it hit me right in the eye. And that was the summer where my dad gave me a black eye, and I had to explain it to all my friends, and maybe it was my poor fielding skills, but that was the summer where my dad gave me a black eye.
This is Bonnie. I'm Bonnie Greenwood. I'm Kenya Greenwood's mom, and she married Jamie, of course. And I pretty much have a good story about my dad as far as the past. When I was a child, we used to go to a lot of barn dances. My dad was a very much businessman. Wasn't the best with kids, but when it came to music or dancing, all of a sudden he changed. You'd get out on the dance floor, he'd grab a hold of you, he'd put you on his feet and waltz and do the polkas and do everything with you on his feet. So I got to learn quite well when I was a child. My parents were like Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire and could waltz around the floor like you wouldn't believe. Another time in my life I remember probably the most with my dad is, even though we weren't that close, I got closer as I got older, is that Christmas was really special to him. He came alive. It was like all of a sudden that very serious, straightforward kind of guy became like a child, and got very excited about Christmas, got excited about handing out the presents, unwrapping them, getting ready for Christmas. He even loved to wrap presents, believe it or not, which most guys don't like to do. So overall, those are probably some of the best times I remember. Other than, he was so stoic when we were at the dinner table, as far as manners go, that my grandfather, who was kind of a little bit, what's the word I'm trying to think of? He tried to cause trouble because he liked to see the human side of my dad, would tell me to pass the rolls. And I would try to pass the rolls around the table. And he said, no, pass the rolls. So he would make me throw the rolls across the table just to see the reaction from my dad, because he was very stoic and everything had to be a certain way. So I do have some good memories of my dad. And his name was Mike. His name before that was Mansford. He hated that name so bad. He had what they call a Norwegian background, and his name was Mansford Jackson. So he changed it to Michael, or Mike, and we were known as the Jackson Five, Michael Jackson Five.
All right, my dad's name is Chip Anderson, affectionately known as Chipper. And I'd say one memorable story I have with my dad, it was kind of a bonding moment. We did a lot of high adventure camping, hiking, backpacking, and one time we went to the Boundary Waters, which is on the northern part of Minnesota, the border of Minnesota and Canada, and we're at a canoeing trip, and we were out, just the two of us, in a canoe, which as you know is probably somewhat unstable if you're trying to walk around a canoe, and we're fishing, and my dad caught one, was reeling it in, northern pike, got loose, and the treble hooks. Actually, the northern pike tends to be a little slippery, and he drops the fish, and the hooks went right into his leg. So you can imagine, all of a sudden the canoe's rocking a little bit. I'm trying to keep it stable on the back. He's got this fish. He's now squeezed to try to like stop it from squirming. Finally gets the fish off, and now my dad's caught. So there's hooks in his leg. I'm trying to hold this canoe steady, and it was one of these moments where he looks at me, I look at him. And if you don't know, that the only way to really get a treble hook out, which has a barb on it, is you can't pull it out. You've got to push it all the way through and then clip it. So luckily, we had just purchased a pair of needle nose pliers, which has a wire cutter on it. So here I am in the front of this canoe now, which is probably pretty much tipped up. I'm trying to push this treble hook through my dad's leg, clip it. Now his leg's swelling up, and I've never paddled so hard to get back to camp, but we were a ways out there. And so it was kind of a bonding moment. The rest of the trip, he was just the toughest guy I know on one kind of sore leg hiking for miles and miles every day with a canoe on his shoulders and then canoeing the rest of the way. But never going to question the toughness of my dad. And to this day, we have that needle-nose pliers, and we keep it for all of our fishing trips moving forward. Love you, Dad.
My father was known as the great J.C. Myers. And the story I'm going to tell you about him is the night Bob and I got engaged. When Bob asked for his hand, my dad, after a few drambuies with Bob, said, "If you ever harm my daughter, I'm going to kill you. And I'm going to do it in such a way you'll know it was me." That was my dad. Now, when Todd came to ask for Christy's hand in marriage, Bob had to say to him, "I got to do this. If you ever harm my daughter, I'm going to kill you." And so the tradition continues. That was my dad.
My name is Jason Polano. My father is John Polano. I'm the oldest. What I remember most with him, well, not most, but certainly a memory of mine would be when we were younger, I used to love getting back scratches. And he did as well. And he actually used to make, I used to make little coupons for him for back scratches on Father's Day. But when those coupons were up, he would actually scratch my back. And the way that he would do it is he would tell me that there were spiders in the room, and he would make little tapping spider sounds, and he would scratch on the bed, and he would scratch on the wall, and he'd say, "The spiders are coming, the spiders are coming." And the spiders would come up, and he'd come on my back, and my back, and he'd scratch my back with what he called the spiders.
What are you pointing to? Oh, my dad. Ben Fortunato is my dad. Dad was always very proud of my accomplishments in high school. I was very good at typing and shorthand. And after I graduated, I had a job at a law firm. And a couple years after that, we planned our wedding, and I invited my boss to the wedding. So when I brought him over to meet my father shook his hand and said, "You know, you're very lucky to have her. She was the best in typing and shorthand in the city of Chicago." And he was very proud of those accomplishments. And I'll never forget that. My boss kind of got a big kick out of that. I don't know what else to say.
So my dad's name is Robert Costello, and my name is Erica Costello. And my favorite memory of him would have to be when he took me to a Cubs game, and it started to pour really bad, so we ran to the train station, and we hid underneath those, I don't know, waiting things for the train. We took a bunch of like funny pictures, and our hair was blowing. It was just really fun. We were soaking wet when we got home. So, yeah.
My father's name is Mike Ross, and probably the most important thing I've learned from him is to measure twice and cut once. When we were remodeling our house, per Rachel, we decided to put in some new cabinet lighting, and we actually drilled through the ceiling because we estimated where the ceiling was instead of measuring it. So I'll always remember to measure twice and cut once.
My father was John Thomas Convey, the son of an Irish immigrant. He was very gregarious, and so he joined a couple of different organizations. And with one of the organizations, he was sent to Virginia Beach on a convention. And when he came back, we met him at the train, and I was very little, still played with dolls, and he was carrying this great big doll for me all the way from Virginia Beach. And I just thought that was just so thoughtful and kind.
When I was young, my dad used to tell my mom that, "Oh, do you want to eat her like corn?" And then they would chase me around the house, grab me, pull me down, and they would tickle me and pretend to eat me like corn. My dad. Dad! I can't do it.
Okay, I'm talking about my dad. When we were younger, he would work on Friday nights. He was home. He'd work Monday through Thursday and Saturdays, but on Fridays he would go bowling. He loved to bowl, and we always knew if he had a good game or a bad game because my father would stop off and buy a bag of shrimp that he would come in and he'd carry these nice hot piping fried shrimp in the bag. And we'd go, Daddy, you had a great game. What series? He goes, well, I bowled a blah, 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 and I won, you know, $25 and I stopped off. So on Friday nights we used to sit and pray, please let Dad don't bowl well because we get shrimp if he does. So it was a great, great event in our lives. We really all know about the shrimp. Ask him, each one of them.
Okay. Hi, this is Rich, and I want to talk about my dad, George Consoli. And when I was a kid, my dad worked two or three jobs constantly, didn't have a lot of money. Wasn't really poverty by any means, but he always tried to make the best he could for our family. With a third grade education, the biggest goal he had was for us to get college educations. And part of that was, during the time I was growing up, he let me meet Ben Fortunato, and who was really kind of a big influence on my life too. And between my dad, George, and Ben, I think I became a better person because of that. My dad really wanted to make sure that I was always thinking about other people around me. He always stressed that, don't worry about what color their skin is, what language they speak, just think about what they're like inside. And what Ben always reinforced was the same thing. And quite frankly, that's made me a better person over the years. And I want to thank both of them for that, because that's something that I've taken to the heart over all my whole life, and I'm carrying it on to my children. So thank you so much. Merry Christmas to all, and have a good evening. Thanks.
Hi, Biagio Fortunato, Ben Fortunato, my dad. I have a story about dad and bowling. We used to go when we were kids all the time because bowling alleys were the only place that was air conditioned during the super hot summers. So we'd go bowling with Dad and Aunt Rosie and Uncle Pete and Uncle Johnny and Uncle Angelo and all of the kids. And we would always go bowling. And one of my best memories that Dad reminded me all the time was when I was in high school. I went to Immaculata High School, and Dad and I were in the father-daughter bowling tournament. And it was either junior year or senior year, and we took first place. And we got this very cheap little trophy, but he was always so proud of it. And he used to tell everybody how we took first place in the father-daughter bowling tournament. And I think somewhere in my house, I still have the trophy.
This is a kind of a Christmas story of my dad. The only time, the one and only time that I saw my dad drunk, he used to work about maybe five or six blocks away from the house. So he would always walk to work. And when he got out, of course, he would walk home, and it would take him, you know, 10 or 15 minutes to get home. But during the Christmas time one year, I was probably, 13, 14 or something like that. My dad went out to the local tavern with the guys after work and would have a bunch of beers and all that kind of stuff. But this one particular time at Christmas time was the only time that I saw him drunk, and the reason why I knew he was drunk was as he was coming down the block, you would kind of be seeing him swaying a little bit. But then when he got to our house, he walked right by it and was probably three or four houses down the street, and I was laughing, and my mom said, go get your dad, and I had to go get him and bring him back. And I remember we put him to bed. And really, that was the only time that I saw my dad really drunk. For the most part, he would have beers and things like that, but he never really got that kind of drunk. So that's my story about my dad, Christmas time.
My name is Relly. My father was Vic Silayan. He was a movie star, a movie actor in the Philippines. He was kind of big in the society, and a well-respected artist, member of the industry. And for me and my siblings, we sort of kept our identity at first in the universities that we were in. Like in my case, this was on the second semester of my freshman year in the university that I was in. And there were just a handful of close friends that I had who knew about my father as Vixilayan. And there was one time when I was having lunch with my dad, and he asked me if the people in the school know the real me and who my father is. And I said, no, just a few friends of mine knew about it. And so he said, it's about time they know who you are. And, you know, people don't really give attention to me because I go to school with worn out pants, shirts. One afternoon, like my father said, he made me drive him to my school. And he wanted me to go to the gate, which was the busiest gate where most of the students would come and go. And it was the time where a lot of students are coming out of the school and going inside the school. Then he stepped out of the car and everyone were surprised to see Vixilayan, the actor. So I didn't want to step out of the car. I was telling my dad, no, Dad, I'll step out. You get in, you get back in. I'll step out on the other gate where no one is there. Okay? He said, no, no, you come out. You come out and let them know. It's about time they know who your dad is. After a couple of minutes of bargaining with my dad, and I decided to step down, and the students were surprised. They were surprised to see that I was with Vixilayan, and at first they were thinking probably he's just a nephew or just a close relative, but then my dad took out his wallet, counted some bills and handed to me and whispered to me, give this to your mom. So everyone was thinking that it was mine, but it was for my mom. Then he asked me to give him a kiss and a hug. I was so embarrassed because I was telling Dad, I'm already in college. You want me to kiss you and hug you here in public? Yes, because they will think that you are just my nephew or just a relative. I want them to know that you are my son. Come on, give Daddy a hug and a kiss. So I had to give him a kiss and a hug, and that was one moment I could not forget with my dad. And he would always tell us that we are no bigger than anybody we meet, not even the homeless people. He said to always look after one another in the family. At the end of the day, it's just you and your siblings who will help each other and try to be the best of what you can be. He was as simple as he could be. And that was my father.
Ray Sarek, my father. From a very early age, I think my dad tried to instill respect for the outdoors and Mother Nature to me. And an example of this is we would go camping and we were really young, and we used to go on walks late at night to enjoy the fresh air and the view of the stars. And my father invented a mythical creature that lives in the woods that likes to attack little young children at night called the snipe. You may have heard of it. And he used to hang back behind us while we were on these walks and throw rocks into the forest and go, oh, I think there's a snipe, you better watch out, and basically just scare the crap out of us. So I'm scarred for life from that. Thanks, Dad.
My father's name is Robert Fortunato, the one and only. And my favorite story about him, my most sentimental, is when it was just nearing my 7th birthday, he got my mom and my brother and me into a car, piled us in, and he said, "We're gonna go pick out paint for your birthday present. We're gonna paint your room." So how exciting is that? We get in the car and we're driving and driving and driving, and I'm like, how long does it take to get to a paint store? So finally, we've been in the car about an hour, and we pull into this farm, and all of a sudden we see Dalmatians everywhere. And so that was our big surprise, is that we were going to get our little, I'm getting emotional. We were going to get our first puppy, Pongo, and that has been our beloved treasure ever since, that everybody has known and loved. So it was a wonderful surprise and a day our family will remember forever.
My father, Raymond Costello, used to beat me to sleep with a stuffed shark for the first 12 years of my life.
Hi, my dad is Fritz Sauber, and the best story that I can remember about him was taking him backpacking, probably, it'd be about 16 years ago. We went backpacking to the Porcupine Mountains. Dad wanted to carry something in his backpack, so we had to load it up with everybody's shoes and pillows, because we didn't want him to carry a lot of heavy stuff. He was rather old at that time. But we backpacked in to the 8-bunk cabin at Porcupine Mountains, and had an evening there, drank some Jaeger, buried the bottle out there, which we do have to go back and find. But first thing in the next morning, my mom and dad went out to the lake, Mirror Lake, and my dad was screaming, "Woo!" because he was taking a bath in the lake with all of us still sleeping in the cabin, and that's what woke us up. So that's the best story that I can remember about my father.
Well, I guess we all have our stories about our dads. You know, everybody always likes to think about their dad as being the perfect father and the disciplinarian. But we all find out that our dads are just like normal people. Then you find out that your dad drinks like you drink. And here I am, I'm dating my wife, Jo, 1970. We go up to do some mushrooming. So up in Wisconsin, literally you go out and you pick raw mushrooms. And then we had grandma who could figure out what was good to eat, what was bad to eat. So the night before they go mushrooming, they're having a card game. And when Joe and I go to bed, my father has been having a good time drinking with the gang, knowing that the next morning he and his friends and all of us are going to go out mushrooming. So we get up in the morning, we go out mushrooming. The next thing I know, here comes my dad. They got him all dressed up and they call him Walterina. My father was so wiped out the next morning when he was wearing this. As you can see, he brought his best purse, his best wig, and lo and behold, he even had his best hat on. I'll always remember this picture of a man who wasn't afraid to show that, you know, he could enjoy life, although all the time he appeared to be serious. So I think all of us would be lucky if you had a father that at one time or another can let his one side be down, and we find out that he's just like everybody else, likes to go out there, have a good time of life. And I'm thankful that he was able to make me what I think I am today, of being a pretty good man and somebody with values who appreciates life. And that's my dad.
Hi, my father's name was Raymond Costello. I'm Rob. One of my, I don't know if it's a favorite memory, but a funny memory, has to do with shared qualities that we both have. And I'll go back to when I was a little kid in Park Forest. And we used to play Army all the time. We played Army for many years. And one day, and I think I was 4 or 5 years old, we were captured by the other guys, and I had this flag in my hand. And a little flag about this tall, they still sell them today. And I'm standing there with this flag, and they shoot us in the firing squad, and I fell down in such a way that the flag, well, and I don't want to get too descriptive, but it went in my throat and caused quite a mess. I run across the street back to the house, and this lady gives me a towel, and, you know, there's quite a mess. And I get into the house, my dad sees it, does the fatherly thing, throws me in the car, gets me to the hospital, and checks me in. The minute he knows the nurses had me and I'm fine, he just went, whoo, I completely passed out, just hit the ground. He had done his job, and he just got to that point, just fell down completely. So there's three stories with this. The second story is that not too many years later, same thing happens with my sister. She goes out on like Christmas Day on her bicycle on the ice and falls and breaks her leg. So, of course, you know, we didn't believe it. There's a long story about that, but ultimately they put a cast on it. And for months she wears this cast, and the day comes for her to get it taken off. Goes to the doctor is going to take it off, my dad's there, my mom's there, and they just have this little saw, and it's just a plaster cast, that's all it is, this little saw, you could probably put it on your finger, it wouldn't hurt you, but they take the saw to the cast, and they start going right down, and my dad saw that, and just, woo, just again, fell down completely, just passed out because of the thought of it all. So, the third story is where I inherited this characteristic. It's many years later, I'm in high school. I'm in biology class, and we're doing blood tests on ourselves. Well, it's not ourselves, it's our lab partner. And Lenny Shortino takes one of those little pin things and sticks my finger. And I thought, no big deal. But he then takes his hand like this, and because no blood was coming out, and he took it and squeezed the heck out of it. And the blood shot out this far. It looked like the scene from The Exorcist, if any of you ever saw that, where Linda Blair gets her spinal tap. It shot out like this. I looked at that, and I just did a dad. I just completely fell flat on my back, passed out completely. So, anyway, that is my odd memory of my dad.
So, I would say that one of the best things that I've gained from my father, John, has been that as I've gotten older, I start to realize how much you really need to put into being a father and the time commitment. And just growing up, he was always so involved in our lives, and it was amazing how he was a coach and he led as the president of a baseball league and a basketball association, and yet still found time to be a dad at home and take a lot of time and be a part of our lives. So. That's one of the things that I've really learned is to be an honorable, respectable person. That's really terrible. I gotta redo that. Sorry. That's two different things. So we'll start again.
Edit.
My dad, John Polano, has been an amazing role model in terms of just being always so giving with his time and his effort as being anywhere from our head coach to baseball and basketball to being the president of the league. Just being so involved in our lives, it's been really amazing as I've gotten older to see how much responsibility he balanced throughout his life.
So my father is an aeronautical engineer. He was the first person, James Data, in the family to have not only a college degree and a high school degree, but also a master's degree. And the thing that my father taught me the most was to think about how you're going to earn for your family. It wasn't about getting married. It was about how are you going to put food on the table? How are you going to put a roof over your head? And you're either going to college or going to school or you're getting a job and you're not living here for free. So he basically put a life lesson in my head that it was all about intellect and how you can make means for yourself and for your family. He said, just get that sheepskin, because intelligence is something that knowledge can take away from you.
Okay, this is a little story about my dad, Biagio, or Ben Fortunato. When I was young, We only had one TV, and we would all have to watch the TV in the same room. Well, once in a while, my dad and I would be watching TV, and he would fall asleep because he had worked his second job. He would fall asleep on the sofa, and as soon as he fell asleep, I went to the TV, and I turned the channel very quietly. As soon as I turned the channel, he'd wake up and say, "Hey, what are you doing? I was watching that." So I would go back to my chair, and I remember one night doing it about 3 or 4 times. I did it so quietly, and the fourth time, I watched it for about 5 minutes, and then he woke up and said, "Hey, what are you doing? I was watching that." And that's my story about Dad. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Chris Castell, and my dad is Robert Castell, and the one memory that always pops into my head is the baseball game we went to, Chicago Cubs. Anyways, he picked me up from school in 6th grade, let me play hooky. My mother was not happy. And in that game, we got bleacher seats. I was baptized in beer that day. Dusty Baker got kicked out of the game. Moises Alou tied the game, and Sammy Sosa came in and hit a home run and won the game in the 9th inning. My dad said that that was the greatest baseball game he's ever been to, and I have to say, it was my first and only baseball game, and I have to agree with him.
My dad, Frank Pilano, passed away in 91, and he, there's a lot of stories I can tell about him, but one that we used my entire life when we were kids. Usually at every get-together, family get-together, my uncle Mario and my dad used to gather around the kids all the time and talk about the war. And one of the unique things about my dad is that he had a cyst on his arm about the size of a golf ball. And the kids, we would always tell the kids, myself included, that because he was in the war, he said there was shrapnel left inside the skin that he never had removed. That's how he got out of the war. So that was a big story, you know, that we had for years and years. And my uncle, who his brother, had an appendicitis, and he had a big scar here. And his story was that he got excused from going into the military because in boot camp he got hit with some kind of a knife or something. So that was one of the funny stories about my dad. Other than that, he was a loving, caring guy, very, very supportive of the family, worked very, very hard for us, and we love him very, very much.
My dad is Walter Flipowitz, or Flip, or Butch, goes by a bunch of different names, and I think if I had to pick one thing that I'd like to either remember him by, or that makes me smile or think of him, it would have to be how he is at weddings. Among my friends, among family, among everybody, kind of has a reputation at weddings of being the guy that gets things started. A different side of him seems to come out. He has done push-ups on the dance floor at the wedding. He's done his 1970s disco spinning, I don't know what it is, down the Congo line at the weddings. He does the "Yeah Baby," you name it, he does it at the weddings. People have never met him before that have been on the other side of the family that have never even seen him before will ask, "Who is that guy?" We've actually been to a wedding in Montana where somebody asked if he was hired to come to the wedding to try and get the wedding started because he was out of control on the dance floor. The song he really gets out of control to is "A Little Bit Louder Now, A Little Bit Louder." He loves going down the floor, and then he starts bringing the crowd back up. Honestly, if he could have any job, it would be the wedding starter, the guy that's brought in to called in from the bullpen to get the wedding going if it's not exciting on the dance floor. But that's a great thing about him is that he can always make people laugh, smile. He's the life of the party. Maybe because he doesn't get to party that often, so when he does, it's built up for a long time, a couple months, a couple years, and it all comes out like the hurricane on the dance floor there. So if I had to pick one thing, that's probably what a most memorable thing would be. Anytime I think of him at a wedding or I think of a wedding, he should be in that movie, Wedding Crashers, goes to parties and just gets it going.
Okay, my dad is Ray Sarek, and this is a story about when we were, or he was still married to my mom. I remember he made dirt cake, and he, in the garage, staged the whole dirt, like he was actually making the potted plant. So he had dirt in the garage, and then he put the pot on the kitchen table with like dirt tracks coming into the house. And after we had all sat down to a nice family dinner, we got out our spoons and we started eating out of the plant on the table. And my mom was like, no, don't eat that. It's dirt. And it was just dirt cake. So that was kind of a fun surprise of my mom. But one other thing is just I always remember him being there for my brother and I as we went through, you know, growing up. Being a separated family, and he was just always a good dad. So.
My dad was Raymond Joseph Costello, Sr. He had a great sense of humor. In his older days, you'd get pretty tired and worn out, like especially during family parties. So one time he's at our house for one of the kids' birthday parties, and he said, would you mind if I went into your living room, laid on the couch, and listened to some music for a while and rested? And I said, sure, no problem. I said, how about if I put on some Rachmaninoff? And he says, oh, that'd be great. And he says, you know, I got to tell you a story about Rachmaninoff. When he was only 24 years old, he had created this magnificent work. And he was going to perform it with his orchestra at this big hall. And he gets there, and this beautiful work is going on, and it ends, and everybody, boo, this stinks, this sucks. And the critics panned it and said it was a horrible piece of work, and it pretty much destroyed Rachmaninoff. For the next few years, he was so shaken by that piece of work, which today is gorgeous. Anyway, my dad tells me that story, and I put the Rachmaninoff on there, and I stay with him to listen to it. And it was beautiful. So many different melodies and notes in there. And it ended, and the last note kind of trailed off, and it ends. And my dad hops up off the couch and goes, boo! Boo! That stinks! To that magnificent piece of work. That was my dad.